Shalom. Once again, you're not under the sounds of the voice of Kahan Tazadok, your brother, Ak Tazadok, an aggrieved man. I do not proclaim myself to be anything other than an aggrieved man standing up and fighting for his rights and teaching my fellow man to fight for his rights and her right, the fellow woman. And as usual, for the record, this is not legal advice. I do not offer legal advice. If you need legal advice, you're in the wrong place. If you need legal advice, seek yourself a competent counsel, and then please, please be advised. What I'm about to present to you is for educational, informational, and even entertainment purposes only. Nothing more than that. Now, I would like to say if you find the information in this video or any of my videos of value, and you would like to show appreciation by donating for my time and energy and educating my fellow man and woman, then please click the PayPal link below to donate whatever value that you feel that this video values, or the information in this video values, for my time and energy, and for second time to educate my fellow man and woman, be it $50, $100, $20, $10, $5, or even a dollar, I can assure you it would go for good use, perhaps getting more equipment to keep putting out videos like these and researching more information. Simply click the PayPal link below this video, or if you need personal coaching by phone or Skype, please email me by clicking the email link below. So, and if you like the video, then take a second to like the video and subscribe to the channel and share this video with as many people as you can. Because the more people that's educated, the more effective that these strategies become. So, I'm going to continue on from where I left off in the last videos. And what I've actually been doing with you is actually been discussing the UCCs. So, I entitled this video, UCC Code, Status, Contracts, Governmental Benefits, Liability, and Non-Residents. So, you know, I was seeing towards the end of the last video, pursuant to the Uniform Commercial Code, a contract can actually be discharged in situations where a living soul or a man, not knowingly, intentionally, and voluntarily entered into the said contract. Now, he is actually, if he's unaware of any presumed terms and liability, you could get discharge, you could rescind that contract. So, and this is often the case in filing the Internal Revenue Form 1040. So, but if we don't know who we are, if we don't know our status with regard to the federal United States, then how can we possibly know if we are a person made liable to the income tax? That's a question. That's a question. Now, in all likelihood, truthfully, folks, brothers and sisters, Akim, in all likelihood, you executed and you signed your first 1040 income tax when you were underage, ignorant and unaware of what you was doing. And because your parents told you that it was a requirement. Is that correct? So, they probably did not tell you whether it was actually a requirement for all people or whether it was a requirement only for people who chose to intentionally subject themselves to governmental servitude, modern day slavery, 14th Amendment citizens, so on and so forth. So, Your father most likely told you exactly what was previously told to him. And neither of you asked how you were made liable for the federal income tax. Is that correct? So, number one, could such a contract be considered a binding contract? It's a question. I'm the king right now because I'm asking. And he that is asking is as the king. Islam, Shalom. Now, would such a contract be considered to be one that was actually entered into under duress? That's a question. Or one that was actually entered to under influence because you was actually coerced or otherwise forcibly misled into believing that you had an obligation to fill out this contract. I'm just asking questions. I'm not giving you legal advice. I'm trying to get you to open your mind. I have another question. Would such a contract be considered to be one that was entered into by mistake? I'm talking about the 1040 form. I'm talking about the IRS's, these taxes that you voluntarily paid. And you may not even have been aware that you may not be obligated to pay them. So, would such a contract be considered one that you actually entered into by mistake? That's a question. Because you were not knowledgeable regarding all terms of the contract and the liabilities of such a contract. It's a question. Could such a contract be found to be fraudulent in nature? Now, I didn't say it was fraudulent in nature. I asked the question. So, could such a contract or an agreement be discharged because of duress, coercion, or its undue, untrue influences, mistake, or fraud? See, those are questions that you need to start answering, asking, and then answering truthfully. And you may find that, hey, you may not be obligated to do so. Now, I've never seen an organization named IRS come after anyone. It's always a man or woman behind that organization that is representing IRS. But you get afraid of those acronyms, of those letters, of these alphabet groups. So, if you find that you have no right of action or recourse against the government or the de facto because they are attempting to impose an unlawful tax, use UCC is what I would do. Section 3-601.2 to discharge the presumed liability. Now, I'm not telling you to do that because obviously I'm not counsel, and I cannot give you legal advice. But, as an aggrieved man, I can educate my fellow man. Liability discharge without prejudice, pursuant to UCC 3-601.3. Remember who said it. Your brother ties a dot. Now, because of circumstances, brothers and sisters, such as this, we must know who we are. Who are you? Who are you? What is your status? Where do you live? What is your country? See, those are questions that you need to know. Who are you? And how do you fit in? Or don't fit in with the corporate government or de facto? Now, as the saying goes, we have to find ourselves. If we don't know who we are, how can we expect others to know who we are? Are you a corporate construct? Now, native-born nationals are one of the continental states of the Union are not affected by federal corporate government, not affected by the de facto, unless, of course, they choose to be via a contract or an agreement, because you have a right. It's a contract. Islam? Shalom. Shalom. Now, as I mentioned in a video, about two videos back that I made, now, there are different and distinct United States, and one does not affect the other except through contract or agreement. So they're each foreign to the other. So because of the fraudulent practices of the players in the federal United States, i.e. the politicians and the bureaucrats, we must, as private nationals, as Moors, as Hebrews, and so on and so forth, as living souls, assert our sovereign alien status in order to prevent this foreign corporate government from falsely presuming that we somehow come under its jurisdiction. 26 Code of the Federal Regulation, Section 1.1-1, states at A, that the code imposes an income tax on the income of every individual who is a citizen or resident of the United States, and to the extent provided by Section 8718 or 877B on the income of a non-resident alien individual. Now, let me ask you a question. Now, if we are foreign to the corporate United States because of our national status, I want you to listen to me well, Moore. I want you to listen to me well, Hebrew. I want you to listen to me well, man, American national. Then we obviously are alien to the United States for purpose of the Internal Revenue Code. Do you understand? So Section 1.87-1 states that the manner of taxing aliens individual as follows, and I quote, A, classes of aliens for purposes of the income tax, alien individuals are divided generally into two classes, namely resident aliens and non-resident aliens. B, classes of non-resident aliens in general for purposes of the income tax, non-resident alien individuals are divided into the following three classes. I, non-resident aliens who at no time during the taxable year are engaged in a trade or business in the United States. So, brothers and sisters, knowing that you are an American national, more Hebrew, Israelite, you must now determine if you've actually engaged in U.S. trade or business, which can make you subject to the corporate United States. So the answer to this question will actually determine whether or not you are a resident alien or a non-resident alien. So even though you are not living within one of the federal owned territories of theirs, if you are engaged in resident business, thereby conducting business via corporate license or government privileges, if you qualify as a native-born, non-regulated individual who is foreign, as myself, to the legislative and the territorial jurisdiction of Congress, you are a non-resident. You are a non-resident alien for taxation purposes. Do you understand? Do you understand? So if you work in a private enterprise, your earnings, not for U.S. source, nor effectively connected with a U.S. source, If you meet these requirements, as do I, you are beyond the scope of the jurisdiction of Congress and the Internal Revenue Service. So you may not qualify to be a taxpayer. The U.S. government, or the de facto's power and authority to limit, to nationalize, or naturalize, should I say, the 14th Amendment citizens and individuals who have actually volunteered to make themselves federal United States, i.e. District of Columbia citizens, unless you volunteer to become subjects to its jurisdiction, folks, you are, for purposes of Congress and the Internal Revenue Code, a non-resident alien. Now the question is, did you volunteer? So once you know who you are, this is why you heard me asking you years ago, back in 2010, 2009, who are you? What is your status? What is your country? Where do you live? It is imperative. It is essential that you know the answer to these questions. If not, you cannot effectively stand as a man. So once you know who you are, you can assert your rights. Oh, I want my constitutional rights. Negro, you don't have any constitutional rights. So in the courts and with regards to government agencies, those rights can actually be found in the Uniform Commercial Code. So with regard to seizures, the Internal Revenue Service is actually limited as to whose property they can seize. They're seizing property. Oh, we're going to take your truck. You didn't pay your taxes on it. So, but I know that when I look at Title 26, USC, Section 7301 and 7302, 5335 too, and 6331, or the sections that state who the government can actually levy and put seizures upon. But do you know that? So, don't believe me. Go and check them out for yourself. Now, I just cited it. I'm giving you remedy. And I highly encourage you to watch this video at least 4 times. But I recommend 10, because this needs to be embedded into your subconscious mind. Because if you watch this once, you're not going to learn it. You're just going to retain probably about 10% of it. You need to watch this at least 4 times, but I recommend 10. Because it would embed it into your subconscious mind. And many of you, you're not going to do this. You're not going to watch it 10 times. You don't have the patience. And you're not going to embed it into your subconscious mind so it'll become automatic. Because you should know this. Then, you're capable of teaching others. Do you understand? So, I want you to go and check it out for yourself. Like I always tell you, don't believe me. Go and check it out for yourself. And you may find that none of these sections actually apply to you. As a man. As an aggrieved man. So, these sections are relevant to the code of the federal regulation, CFR. Section 301.63.2-1. Which clearly states the Internal Revenue Service can only levy government-held property of employees of officials of the government. Of the government. So now, remember, if you are actually engaged in privileged corporate business that is actually effectively connected to the federal states, you are considered a resident. Or a resident alien, and you are an employee or official of the government. The de facto existed in fact, but not officially established. So we have previously been under the misconception that we are subjects to these seizures. So we... No. Let me put that in a phrase of a question. Were we fraudulently led to believe that we are a federal citizen of the United States? Were we fraudulently led to believe that we had an obligation to incorporate our business? You want to do hair? You incorporate it. You want to be a personal trainer? You incorporate it. You want to be a mechanic? You incorporate it. Or get a license. And because of this, you're a truck driver. We have actually subject ourselves to the jurisdiction of the United States corporate government. Shame on you for your ignorance. Now, if you do not knowingly, voluntarily, and intentionally enter into these contracts, can you be held liable? That's a question. Wouldn't such a claim or a chain of events constitute fraud on the government's part? It's a question. And mistake acting under duress and or undue influence on your part. Wouldn't such a chain of events leave you without action or recourse? It's a question. So, discharge the presumed liability, folks, without prejudice, pursuant to Uniform Commercial Code 3-601.3. I'm going to say that again, and I'm going to say it slowly. For informational purposes, discharge the presumed liability without prejudice, pursuant to Uniform Commercial Code 3-601.3. Because the United States the United States government's possible fraudulent behavior, and because of our incapacity, you know, being unable to prevent government false presumptions, any contract that we may have with the government must be under duress and must be conducted ambiguously. UCC 1-103 gives you a way back to the real law. I do not accept these benefits openly. If I have received a benefit, it was received ambiguously because of the fraud in the essence. I would not have accepted a benefit if I had known of the ramifications of the presumed agreement. Now, this is just me thinking out loud. I'm not giving you any kind of legal advice. Now, let it be known that you do not accept their benefits openly and voluntarily. Obviously, in order to survive, you sometimes find yourself in the position of receiving corporate benefits. Now, I could understand that of the government-owned utilities, government-grown produce, government-raised protein, and many other government-manufactured merchandise. Do you understand? But receipt of government benefits is under protest, pursuant to UCC 1-308, formerly 1-207, and 3-3052C. So, brothers, sisters, ladies, the following or more examples that I'm about to give you of situations wherein we had discharged fraudulent liabilities placed upon us by the de facto, by the government. The necessity of doing business with one or more government corporations because of incapacity. Another example, because the government exchanged gold and silver for valueless paper money, they have gained access to your property. And because this is the only medium of exchange made available to me, ta-da-da, a man, it has caused the country and its people to be in debt to the government. So, as an aggrieved man, I, Tazadak Shabay, states the following. If I give the appearance of being in debt to the government, it is because I am left without any action or recourse. No remedy available. Liability discharge pursuant to UCC Section 3-305 and 3.6013. Do you understand? So, never admit to accepting a benefit, my brother, my sister. Now, although you might be forced to receive it, use it because of the government monopoly. Never refer to this incapacity as acceptance. Remember, I taught you years ago, acceptance is agreement. Acceptance denotes voluntary action. Acceptance denotes voluntary action. So, with that, I'm going to bring this one to a close. I'll continue on with more information. I'm trying not to make these videos too long because many of you get all discombobulated. You don't want to continue watching. You get distracted. So with that, I'm going to bring this one to an end. And if you found the information in this video or any of my videos of value and you would like to show your appreciation by donating for my time, energy, and for educating my fellow man and the people abroad, please click the PayPal link below this video and donate whatever amount, whatever value that you feel that this information and my time and energy is worth in this video, be it $50, $100, $20, $10, $5, or even $1. And be sure to like the video if you liked the video, if you found it very informative. Subscribe to the channel and share this information with as many people as possible. Education is power. Now, if you need personal coaching by phone or even by Skype, then click the email link below this video and someone will be in contact with you. So until next time, I'm Taza Doc. I trust that you've learned something from this. Watch the video at least 4 times so this could actually be embedded into your subconscious mind, but I recommend 10. So until next time, to you, brothers and sisters, I'm saying shalom, and to you more, I say Islam.